On this week's Garnet Research Roundup, I'm really delighted to be joined by Henrik Jonsson and Benoit Langin from the Sainsbury Lab in Cambridge. And we're going to talk about a paper just published in PNAS, the title of which is Nitrate Modulates Stem Cell Dynamics in Arabidopsis Shoot Meristems Through Cytokinins. So thanks very much, guys, for joining us today. And it would be great if you can give us an overview of the paper, please.
Okay, so the aim of our paper is to see what is the impact of mineral nutrition, and especially nitrates, on the homeostasis of the meristem, of the inflorescence meristem. Mm-hmm. Because there's quite a lot that is known on the impact of nutrients and nitrates on root system, but very few is known about how that can impact on the inflorescence meristem. And basically what we have shown is that the hormone cytokinin is very important to link the nutrient status of the plants and the nitrate status of the plants with the inflorescence meristem function. And the way it works is that the nutrition, and that was known already, can induce cytokinin biosynthesis in the root, and then that goes to the inflorescence meristem, and that can tune stem cell homeostasis and through that meristem function. So our paper kind of link together what's happening in the root system and what's happening in the inflorescence meristem system.
Okay. So can you take us through some of the experimental techniques that you used in the paper?
Okay. So a lot of what we do is based on confocal microscopy. Mm-hmm. And so we image meristems, inflorescence meristems that are expressing different markers like stem cell related to stem cell regulation, like promoter fusion for Virchow or cytokinin response. And we actually then try to correlate the signal we see by confocal to the different treatment we apply to the plant, like different levels of nitrate. Mm-hmm. And then we use as well grafting experiments to basically change the genotype in the root, like mutant that have defects in biosynthesis of cytokinin, and see the effect that has on the inflorescence meristem. And then at the end of the paper, we focus more on like transient response and look directly, apply a treatment, which is there in like applying directly nitrate to the plant and see the direct response through time courses of the meristem to this treatment.
Okay, so you mentioned in your initial description the key component that it's really transported cytokinin, which is key in this response. So can you give an overview of the experiments you did to show that that was the case, and it wasn't cytokinin that was synthesized at the site of the meristem?
Yeah, so what is moving is actually not the active cytokinin, it's the cytokinin precursor that is produced by enzyme called isopentanyl transferase.
Okay.
And we know that from a paper that's been published last year that we our data support as well. And an experiment that showed that is that if you take an IPT mutant, that is a dwarf plant, mm-hmm. Because you have less cytokinin. But then if you add a Y-type root to that plant, then you have a Y-type looking plant, and the meristem can respond to changes in nutrients, for instance. And that is because the Y-type root produces that precursor that can then move to the shoot and to the effect in the meristem. But then if you do that with the enzyme that produces the active cytokinin, which is the log enzyme for lonely guy, mm-hmm. that effect doesn't work. So grafting a Y-type root will not be able to complement the phenotype in the meristem of lonely guy mutants.
Yeah,
and because those guys are expressed directly there in the meristem.
Okay. So I know that quite a few people at Sainsbury Lab do some grafting experiments, I know. So with the Arabidopsis, you know, having worked with the Arabidopsis, that seems pretty tricky to me. So does it work like every single time, or what's your success rate with the grafts?
So that's a good point. So actually, it's as well, we do a lot thanks to Charles Menick, who is a co-author in the paper,
yeah, okay.
And he actually teach me the grafting. So I can't get to levels of success that is the level he has. So I think he can get up to like 75-80% okay. success. So for me, it's like 50%. So it's kind of laborious indeed. But then because it's just based on seedlings that are just germinating, you can just do a lot of them. So even if your success rate is not that great, then you compensate with that.
Yeah, okay. And you do the graft at the base of the hypocotyl, yeah? Is that right?
Yeah, so what you do is that you cut the hypocotyl at like 1 week old, on 1 week old seedling.
Okay.
And then you do the connection at this time, and then you put them on soil after when they're reconnected.
Okay. Maybe this is a question for future work, but so we know that auxin, of course, plays a significant role in the in meristem development with expression of pins and the movement of auxin throughout the meristem. Is there any linkage with auxin to the nitrate signal, or are you looking to see if there's interaction between cytokinin and auxin in the control of this nitrate signal at all?
So I would say so far we haven't seen the direct connection of these. But okay. Of course, there are some recent papers now showing connections between the cytokinin and the auxin pathways, in particular in the roots, people have shown this. Mm-hmm. So for sure that could be a quite interesting thing. Still, I mean, it seems to be the cytokinin moving from the roots to the shoot is really the key thing, and then converting to the active form. But we have no indication auxin is really involved in this.
I actually looked at mutants that were altered in, you know, auxin biosynthesis and transport, and for that specific aspect, because we look at stem cell regulation, it didn't seem to have an impact. Although it is known that auxin levels and response can be also influenced by nitrates, at least in the roots.
I mentioned a little bit of future work there, but so can you give an overview where you're going to take this work in the future? What's the next steps where this work will be going?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is really interesting in terms of as Benoit has described, that we have now connected the paths and we know we had the graft and what is sufficient, what is necessary to have in the root and shoots and so on. Mm-hmm. Of course, I have a background in theoretical works, so I would very much like to put this now into like a multi-scale model,
okay,
trying to understand how the quantitatively the transport works and how it can affect the meristem size and possibly also the shape and so on, and the induction of flowering or the flower production. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the steps I think we really want to do. I'm also quite intrigued by the fact that it's so quick. So you do add nitrates, and suddenly a day later the meristem responds. Okay. And this is typically the same time scale as if you do perturb the clavata, for example, in the meristem, you see a response on a similar time scale. Okay. So that also opens up for lots of kind of interesting interactions and how those feedbacks are actually working. Mm-hmm. And what Benoit also found was that in some of these cases he had investigated it, I mean, he has put more or less 3,000 stacks of images of measuring the size of these expression domains online. is this that sometimes there is a disconnection between the Wuchel and Clavada that hasn't really been investigated before. So that opens up a completely new kind of regulation of the Clavada Wuchel system itself.
Okay. So just a final question, and kind of linked to your answer a little bit and the pace of that activity. Do you have evidence that you said that the precursors are moving through the vasculature? So is that through the xylem or through the phloem? Do you have any sense exactly the tissues that these precursors are moving through?
So that actually has been studied before a bit, okay, and it's actually moving from the xylem okay, in this case. And actually people have been measuring the concentration of cytokinin precursor and lytic cytokinin within the xylem sap, and have been able to measure that there was like increase when you increase the nutrition.
All right, well, thanks so much, guys. I mean, I urge everyone to have a look at the paper. It's nicely set out. The experiments are very stepwise, and there's some beautiful images of the meristems. So, yeah, thanks very much for chatting, and we, as ever, we look forward to hearing about your next outputs on this area. Thanks very much.
Thank you.